Ah, okay, let's resume the meeting. Charles, mark 5 minutes. In the early part of the meeting, I heard some members asked about the use, the industrial land issue. And not only the private operators who need some industrial land, the government is also seeking industrial land. For example, the future industrial estate is still identifying sites. I wonder what's the progress. We can't say that Hong Kong don't have a demand for commercial industrial land. Actually, the demand is quite keen in my constituency for the big data centers like Google, and they need to choose elsewhere instead of Hong Kong, even though they already have the groundbreaking ceremony. They prefer to abandon the site. Not that we don't have a site for them, it's just we don't have the planning as such. As for what's the blueprint for the next decade or so, when you get to Taiwan to Singapore, this is provided for them. So we discuss other projects like the review loop. And remember, Mr. Chu asked for this new NT North and WNT. There have been talks for reserving land for at the tech industry. However, there aren't any details or actual planning. So, Mr. Chu, question would be based on whether do we really need that much or we need to convert to other uses. Of course, there are a demand for residential housing. We're not just talk about for luxury housing, for our public housing and so on. However, we see that in practice, that our sector, we'd like to know what's the future planning. So the insufficient communication, especially with the planning department. So we could just bring it briefly for the large-scale consultation and none afterwards. So when we need to find out from our policy bureau, they don't know anything. So since we are talking about the creation of this new post, that I wonder if this can be the communication with different sectors can be improved, including my own, for example, telecommunications and data centers. So in terms of the job description, can that be included as well? Deputy Secretary, thank you, Chairman, and Mr. Mark's question. His concern was for from a planning perspective, this is what we call a special industrial use, for example, logistics at the data center you mentioned. So when we carry out the study for 2030 plus, in the long run, the special industrial site is at a shortfall. So for the planning studies conduct in new territories, we found a suitable site, we will consider reserving more land for such purpose. So let me take some example for Tumen West, the area 46. We have reserved some site for special industries for Nam Te, for example, for the NDA in Tung Shui Q. So Mr. Mark mentioned that while carrying this kind of planning, there will be more interaction with the sectors. That can be done. So while we are carrying these planning studies, there will be two or three rounds of public engagement exercise. So we can take it up with the planning department to make sure they take notice, so that when we're conducting a planning study that's related to special purpose site, or let's say IT sector, for example, to have more frequent contact to gauge your sector's demand for land. I think we need to step up communication as for the need to inform the sector of any upcoming public consultation, or let's say for Tumen Area 46, these are the existing or finalized it programs and so forth. So maybe I'll go check it out with you after the meeting and for the existing ones or those in the pipelines. So if you can give a clear picture for the sector, and they might have other requests to relate to you as well. So you haven't quite replied to me that whether this new post will help to this end, that would be taking up communications and liaison.
Thank you, Chairman, and the members' question.
For such kind of planning studies, for the actual work will be undertaken by the planning department, well, with the engaging consultant. And today, this post creation, the first one will be for the Development Bureau. The PASPL7 will oversee the policy on industrial land. As for the planning studies by the planning department, it's part of the responsibility to supervise it. So I would say they're related. So we have three more members who would like to speak: Dr. Fernand Cheung, Jeremy Tam, and Chu Hoi Tik. Anyone else would like to talk? Mr. Chan, you don't plan to. I'm thinking what to ask. You just press the button first. So we draw the line here. So we talked about this for over 2 hours. We have quite a compressed schedule here together with Dr. Julius Ho. 5 minutes. Oh, it's my turn already. Oh, so you take priority, actually. So I has to view that I'm not part of the ESC. However, I see the governments keep on creating more posts. I don't feel too positive on this. So what's the urgency of creating this post? So I glanced through the document briefly. I know that in terms of planning, because we need to boost our land supply, so Development Bureau and the Planning Department will need this personnel to help on this front. However, I don't think this can be achieved by adding more people. They also need to take a look at the policy direction. So for the you list out where the brownfield sites are, you list out three reasons. So we need to vacate the brownfields. We need to, how do we could try to transform them? Then we need to revitalize industry buildings. How to the biggest source of land must be new territories, whether through excavation or a rezoning the outskirts of country park. If not the first two must be done through reclamation. It's more a matter of policy. If you have a clear policy that do we think that we have a lack of personnel? So I don't think it's really tied in with the 2017 to 2027 target. You want to rezone your brownfield sites. So that's the biggest measure so far. So how can we make sure that the brownfield sites will become residential use? It's more as a matter of policy. So if you haven't finalized on a policy and yet you create this post first of having this directorate officers, it seems to be getting your priorities upside down. So if you had a clear policy to boost land resumption and so on, you need people personnel to steer with that. So that I get it. So to create the policy is simply not in good shape. I think in terms of land resumption, besides that we use for public facilities such as roads and public housing, there weren't used for any other purposes. For the private developer, have accumulated large tracts of agricultural land. How can we put this land in private hands into good use? That's the greatest technical difficulty. And Mr. Chu have said that if you tell too much to private developers, then it will be collusion. So how do we adjust the mentality? So the problem must be solved by the government itself. So 3 minutes into my question, in the past, back in the colonial era, the letter B is actually a good thing. I asked Roger Leesum, this letter B Can it be restarted? Julius, then he replied, Julius, it's not working anymore. When we develop the new towns that we don't have any money, what if for the original inhabitants, for those landowners, when they liberate the land from the Chou Tongs, we don't have any money to compensate them. So it's very difficult to get the land if we don't have any. It's very difficult to resume the land without the money. That's why we invented letter B. Either you pay in cash or land entitlement to exchange for this land to expedite the process. So back then we have such a historical background, but now that Hong Kong government is quite rich, it's just a matter of whether we are offering enough compensation that for our excretion payments only for the adjustment for years. And for the urban class A, there will be over 1,000 square meters, and followed by class B, C, D. I think we institute the letter B system. As for the holder of the certificates can exchange for the land to increase the land turnover. Now that we have the money, but the owners have no intention to exchange for the land. Now that we use a letter B as the exchange mechanism. That's my suggestion.
Yeah. So next, Dr. Fernando Chang, 4 minutes. I'd like to follow up on Joy Dick's point. There are 104 sites that can be developed, as you said. Now there's a disparity. Now there's some private land that is sites for development of private residential units. The unit area is much larger than that for public housing units. Shusen Hill, for instance, 136,000 square feet, average 4,000 plus square feet per unit. Now, Tuen Mun area 39, that's 0.67 hectares, that is 70,000 square feet for 1,200 units, average 70 square feet per unit. Now, as for another development compared to Shusen Hill development, it's 60 times or 1/60. Now you say you build a certain proportion of public housing, but actually there's a huge disparity between land for the rich and land for the poor. Now how do you do your planning? Is it that for public housing you just build buildings everywhere you can, and then for private housing you let them be huge so that they are very expensive? Now you say 60-40, that's your ratio, but actually when it comes to the use of the land, now it's this great disparity. And then there are three golf courses that you don't touch, and then you leave this land to the rich to play golf. So is it like in the budget? Now you don't distribute to the poor, but you distribute to the rich. Deputy Secretary, now for each site, whether it should be used for public housing or private housing, and as the number of units, it depends on the site. For instance, Shusen Hill, that's a low density development. Now, in terms of transport infrastructure, multi-story residential development is not supported there. Now, when we build public housing, we want to find sites which are near mass transport systems, like the MTR or major trunk routes, so that those grassroots families who live there can be facilitated. Now, so that's how we determine the sites. 20 Chun, 4 minutes. To follow up on my earlier question, the PAS PL7, now that person will implement the brownfield sites policy, it will watch over the implementation. Now, so how can it be just 4 years? You will resolve the brownfield sites issue within 4 years? Now, the Deputy Secretary said that in New Territories, Northeast, in Hongshoukou, etc., there are some that are ready, but there will be more in the future. And then there will be 2 permanent posts. The second one, excuse me for a minute. Now, the Chief Town Planner for the Housing and Office Land Supply section. Now, is that something that will be perpetually required? We thank the member for his question. On the supernumerary post, I will speak on that. Now, at Development Bureau, this is time-limited post. It lasts till March 2022. At that time, we will review the work. Now, the PAS PL7 will be responsible for work that is currently being undertaken by another colleague, who is now given new duties. So we will look at the deployment when that time comes. When the post is about to expire in 2022, if there is a need, we will come back to LegCo to apply for the funding. So the work needs to be done continuously. He will monitor the brownfield sites, how they are going to be used, to be made ready until they can be used. Now, the work will continue, but the workload may not stay constant. Now, monitoring the implementation may not require the same amount of work. So the major policy will be established within the term of this officer. Correct. Mr. So, on the planning, Chief Town Planner post for office and land supply, for housing and office land supply. Now, this work will be ongoing. So, land supply is a long-term need, and housing and office land supply is a perpetual need. So, there is a new need for this permanent post. So, this is more than just an automatic implementation of a policy. He will have to implement a policy, and the policy will be long-term. 10 men hold, 3 minutes. Now, on the PAS PL7 post. Now, the areas of duties are very wide, brownfield sites, etc. Now, and he will be supported by a four-person team. Now, does that mean this person will only have four persons under him in his team? Now, there's a large amount of work. How can that be adequate? Is it more than that? Is it more than four? Now, actually, there will be only four. Now, very often, the planning department and CDD also lend support, and they offer very good support to us. They are more proficient with the technical details, so we have to learn from them. So at the Bureau, we have only four staff supporting BASPL7, but the Bureau and the departments are behind him. Now, this is a D2 post, a directorate grade post. Now, maybe I'm rather ignorant, but this is an important post. Now, four staff, one senior administrative officer, a surveyor, and a clerical officer. So there's actually only one technical officer, that is the surveyor, supporting him. Now, as for support from other departments, now, will that be adequate? Will the person be able to do the job? Now, you said that there will be officers from other sections helping him, but he may not be able to assign them work because they have their own duties. So, will there be additional personnel at the other sections as well? The Deputy Secretary? We thank the member for his question. Now, he will have four staff. One is a senior officer, SEO. There will SAO. There will be a EO. There is a lot of planning involved. So, we will have a senior town planner supporting him. So, there will be more support on the planning side. There will be no engineer. Now, for revitalization of industrial buildings, now you need an engineer to look at fire safety issues and so on. Now, but there is none in support of him. Now, he has to do certain things on his own initiative. Now, the member need not be so concerned. The building department is also under us. So when there's going to be a meeting, we can ask them to join. Now, as for fire services, that's under Security Bureau. So we have to work on an interdepartmental or interbureau basis to get the comments. Should I take 3 minutes? Now, I'm not trying to give the DS a difficult time. I'm trying to tell the administration. Right now, in the search of land initiative, now, I have 3 points to make. Now, Dr. Fernando Cheung mentioned that in the rezoning process for residential developments, there are some disadvantaged groups, such as the residents of one child formerly, or the Zhang Shitan in Taipo, and the home for the mentally handicapped in Tuen Mun that I referred to just now. Now, they are rather not so knowledgeable. Now, the town planning board just posts a notice that the villagers don't understand and the villagers don't know how to go on the internet. So, if you don't take the initiative to notify them, they wouldn't know. They only find out when the lands department instigates the resumption process, or they only learn when the members like us go to visit them. So you should take the initiative. You shouldn't wait for lands department. Now, in Taipo, for instance, you rezone 10 sites, then maybe there are one or two of them which would be used for luxurious developments. And green belts, now GIC sites, those have value. Now, we are sacrificing those places, those housing for the masses, and shouldn't just cater to the rich. And you said that in the coming 10 years, there will be 180,000 private housing units supplied. You should add some terms. Otherwise, the rich families will just mop them up. There are so many rich people, only 20,000 units a year. The 180,000 over 10 years wouldn't materialize. That's why I am so dissatisfied with the post of Chief Town Planner. So I wouldn't be able to reject this, but I hope you will take on board my views. Now, Chen Qichun has we now have a motion, 37A motion from Chen Qichun. The bell shall ring for 3 minutes. In accordance with the Finance Committee procedure 37A, I move this motion that given that in the funding document, the Principal Assistant Secretary Planning and Land Sevens, one of the duties is to formulate revitalization of industrial buildings policy measures and to supervise the relevant measures and implementation. And many members are concerned that this scheme will affect the art groups so that they cannot afford their workplaces. This committee asks that the PL7 post will, in formulating the policy, should make sure that there will be no adverse impact on the art groups.
Members, we're going to vote on the motion and there is a request that we should vote on three separate motions. First of all, members are asked to vote on the motion moved by Mr. Chen Jichun. Voting begins. Voting is now closed. We'll display the results. 15 for, 17 against, one abstention. I declare that the committee will not deal with this motion. So if there are no further questions, I will now put FCR 2017-2018-63 to the vote. First of all, the proposal to create a one supernumerary post of a Mr. Officer, Staff Grade D in the Planning Department. Oh, you're calling for a division. Okay. Yes, please call the... Well, we need to also ring the division bell then. We will be voting on the proposal to create the first post. I think you may refer to the paper. Voting begins. Voting is now closed. We'll display the results. We have 26 in favor, 0 against, and 7 abstention. I declare that the proposal is carried. Next, we will now vote on Proposal B, creation of one permanent Chief Town Planner post to be designated as Chief Town Planning Planner, Housing and Office Land Supply, to lead the Housing and Office Land Supply section of the Planning Department for the continuing implementation of policy initiatives to increase land supply. All right? We will now once again ring the division bell.
同事记住啊，主席个麦要常开啊。
Please remember that the chairman's mic is always on. All right, voting now begins. Voting is now closed and we'll display the result. 23 in favor, 5 against, 4 abstentions. So the proposal is carried. The last item is the redeployment of an existing permanent chief town planner post within the planning department to oversee the district planning work for Shengshui Fenling and Yunlong East. All right, we'll ring the bell now for 5 minutes.
因為我都買一個鐘啫喎，好啊，我都唔想處理呢個。你要俾佢哋喎，知啦，但係都冇可能嘅，可能即係驚佢喐佢，喐佢咪大家講嘢咯。 我提一提大家呢,
remind members that we will be voting on whether we support the redeployment of one chief town planner post within the planning department to oversee the district planning work for Fanning Shengshui and Yunlong East. Voting begins now. Voting is now closed and we'll display the results. 31 for, 1 against and no abstention. I declare that the proposal is carried. Next, we will now move on to FCR 2017-2018-63. And the paper would invite members to approve a total allocation of 1,241 million dollars for 2018-2019 for the block allocation subheads under the Capital Works Reserve Fund. And members have requested that the that there should be separate voting for this item. At the last meeting, we already spent 5 hours, 10 minutes on this paper, the PWSC. To answer members' questions, we have Ms. Lau Ching and the Secretary, Mr. James Lau, is here, together with his team. There are many on the team, so I won't introduce them one by one.
As I know, the secretary would like to speak. So, Mr. Lau, the government is asking the Finance Committee to approve the total allocation for the block allocation surplus under the Capital Works Reserve Fund to a total of $12.4919 billion. About $9.8179 billion will be works related. And this block allocation had a widespread consequence, including preventing landslips, refurbished government buildings, drainage, waterworks, and highway maintenance. As for the minor works for school campuses, as for Category B works, in which would help to preparatory work. And the projects to be engaged in 2018-19, there were over 10,000 of them. About 9,000 of them are already underway. The government will need that at the end of this financial year, that's before 1st of April, to request to approve the total allocation. Otherwise, the 9,000-something block allocation projects will need to be halted. And for the 1,000-something projects need to begin next financial year will not commence. This, besides, will affect the public's service, and there will be a huge impact to the contractors, a lot of them being small and medium enterprises, and the lack of liquidity will lead to closures and affecting tens of thousands of workers. The government department is glad to answer any questions from members and hope that members will approve this allegation. Let me make a declaration that I'm the independent non-executive director of Bank of East Asia. The secretary, can you mention some of the changes in for this application? In the letter written on February 28th, we're written to the Legislative Secretariat to follow on the November 28th items and explain in the Appendix 2. The Development Bureau has provided some information to and illustrate that the underlying resumption of the capital, for example, 104CA and 111CA of the as the ceiling for the subheads and explained as such. And on paragraph 9, we noticed that members are concerned that whether they will let you some effect accompli the and affect the FC vetting. So for in paragraph 9, we listed very clearly that in order to dispel the fears of the members and discern that the FC had the right to approve block allocation subject the government to two undertakings, that one, under normal circumstances, upon the approval of the FC or the authority, when need to conduct a land assumptions for the purpose of public works, they would not begin the land clearance works. And second, under some circumstances, if for individual works projects had deviated from normal practice, the government will first consult the relevant panels. So we think that this should demonstrate our sincerity. Before allowing for the questioning, I wanted members' comments on these two arrangements. Mr. Chihoy-Dick, I haven't read the letter. However, I heard that, let's say, if you would like to, the government would need to cheat, that could be discussed at the electrical panels. If the electrical panels have a member's motion that vetoes this arrangement, so how would you respond? Mr. Lau? Well, while we keep briefing and the manuals, we will take into account of the members' views. Of course, we will note the members' concerns and the urgency of the projects. We will deal with that accordingly. Chairman, like Mr. James Lau has said, the general principle was that this is more a reserve fund. And if this project, if they approve that, that you will get the money and begin the land resumption procedures. If the panel have give a clear position that you should leave it alone, that we have a member's motion that was passed, if you insist on proceeding, you need to come back to FC that you should refund. You have to come back to FC to seek permission for use of funding for land resumption. So I was let's Development Bureau of Ms. Hopuling to respond. So maybe just give a bit more background. So last time Mr. Chu made this proposal, we had an evaluation with the departments concerned. The works department, they have some internal guidelines on which they emphasize that if the works department have asked the lands department that before getting the funding for the works, they do need to commence the land resumption or clearance, they need to exercise extra caution or have strong rationale to proceed. So that the internal guidelines already asked the works departments to be able to do so. And for the past 5 years, we found that about 33 projects involving the resumption of private land. So in response to members' concern that before we get the funding for the works, then we commence to you land resumption procedures before it, about that only take up a 5 out of 33 cases, and the Wang Chao is one of them. That is another set of facts. So noting this two facts, so unless there are strong grounds, otherwise your works department should only commence the land resumption after getting the funding or asking the lands department to commence the resumption or clearance. And in most cases, that's how the works department do it. So in response to Mr. Chu's question, I think we gave a commensurate response. So we suggest we reiterate these principles to the Works Department, and we should also modify the internal guidelines to make it more explicit, and our undertaking to members that in future, so as a in principle arrangement, that only after getting the funding for the works, and we should start the land resumption and clearance. If where the situation it have to do the other way around, we will go back to the panels. If the panel pass a motion, what will happen? But then the government will need to reconsider. If the members have such strong views that you're not supporting the government to first resume the land before getting the funding for the projects, if the departments decide to bulldoze the application, I don't think there was sufficient support in Lechko. I think the departments will adjust their handling accordingly. Turn on Ms. Chu's mic, please. I understand the views of Deputy Secretary, but I disagree. I thought you have a brief question. Why not? You can just use your minute slot. Will you be here next time, Mr. James Lau? Yes. So, I think I will be attending. So that we have plenty of time then. So that's how I suggest. Because we have ended the block vote for this year, this about the how we should reform the whole mechanism. So maybe before we enter discussion for the whole block mechanism, there's a stage we can discuss. So what are the views of other members? I see a lot of members putting up their hands. Mr. Lau Kwok Fan, well, okay, we had a queue here. So I'm actually the second one to speak. Well, frankly speaking, so as respond to Mr. Chu's speech, so after getting the land resumption funding but having and making this way a fait accompli, I'll have a different view. I want to share. So should I speak now or should I stick with the speaking order? So that's why. So if you don't mind, we can talk about these general principles before entering this agenda item. Maybe some of the objections from me would like to leave, so we'll discuss the agenda item now. So for those who agree with us, put up your hand. So those who agree to talk with general principles, put up your hand. So let's say we all agreed. I see the majority support here. So we shall stick with the speaking orders. So who would like to speak on this general principles? So please jot down the names. So Dr. Cheung, you're not speaking. So Mr. Lau Kwok Fan, you can speak first. So for the ENT, so waiting for Development Bureau or THB on the resettling and resumption procedures on the asset and income test, rather. Let's say if we reach a consensus, the villagers or the affected squatters are willing to surrender their land, they actually propose to me and hoping to resume the land occupied by the squatter at one go. I mentioned this to Development and Bureau and THB Bureau in previous occasions. The reason is this NENT has divided into three phases of development. And since after the work has started, then the land resumption would commence. And in phase two next to it, before the commence of the work, the land resumption has yet to begin. But now that the works have begun, and then there will be a lot of dust, and it will affect the inhabitants still living there. They would rather get the compensation and resettled early and surrender their land and into public housing and so on. They want to be quick. I've asked Development Bureau if the resident have such desire, so may So after you set up the mechanism and do the land resumption in one go, and the brewery replied that they cannot, because according to the mechanism, the only the works will get to that location that will get the funding for the resumption. So for such a big scheme, you have to divide into phase. There are a lot of the residents will hope that they will land will resume with one go. I'm still standing with the brews. Is there any way to enhance or have some flexibility under this mechanism so that the government can resume the land first instead of have the residents waiting? After the first phase of any NT, so the house will be resumed in a few years' time. They don't feel like they're worth spending money on maintenance and so on, and asking to stick for a few years, so why don't you just rather move to public housing early instead? So these are different views on this matter. I hope that the government can explain that for the any NT cases that can be achieved under on this mechanism. Ms. Ho, Deputy Secretary, thank you for Mr. Ho Lau's question. As for your suggestion, we heard before, I understand your concern is that since you have decided on the scope of the NDA, and yet the work will be conducted in stages, and it will only be allowed the land resumption in the later stages, the daily lives of the residents will be disrupted. Therefore, the suggestion will be whether we are resumed at an earlier time instead of later. That we can consider. But I must say that even for your suggestion, in our document, as mentioned by the Secretary for Paragraph 9, that can be deal with that as well. Because in principle, that we will get the works funding before commencing the resumption procedure. If necessary, we can do it the other way around. The way we do it, that we will come to the panel to discuss. So your suggestion that according to our latest proposal can be dealt with, if you don't take it up to the electrical panels, I will take it up to the panels asking you to resume all the land in the NENT. If we achieve the concession and hope that they could resettle in Pochakwe village in Xiangshui. For the phase one, they could be resettled right away. For the phase two, phase three, because it's yet to be their turn, they were not able to be resettled to this housing estate. So by that time they'll be ran out of public housing in Xiangshui, they wouldn't be resettled in other districts. I hope that government will have some flexibility. So for the new arrangement, or the I agreed with it. I'm asking, requesting you to resume all the land at one go, if able to reach a consensus. That is. So you heard, Mr. Lau, Mr. Chu. Do we have 5 minutes? Yeah. So I'm not. My view is not in conflict with Mr. Lau. So it's just a misunderstanding. So the request made by Mr. Lau, it would be acceptable to me. However, the way I want to do it is that I hope that the Lechko FC will have a chance to do a confirmation, because the public will not be familiar that when we use this block allocation, in which there are thousands of projects together with the land resumption expenditure. So maybe the land resumption for NENT will involve billions of dollars, so we're not able to discuss such a huge major matter on itself. So the government had promised us that when we get to the before the approval for the works funding for NENT, they would keep that funding for a land resumption as a reserved. So if they had a need to use that money, they would come to the electrical for discussion. I think that this arrangement is far from perfect because it's not respectful of this chamber enough. Because if the panel had come up with a motion to reject this government suggestion, so the legislature would have consensus is that this is not right, that this so-called cheating is simply not on. So I think the legislature should have to write where the FC is the suitable venue and to deal with this funding for the then resumption, whether to be accorded a priority for approval. So therefore, I don't think there's any fundamental difference with Mr. Lau. As for the separate voting mechanism, in the reply from Mr. James Lau, it mentioned that Mr. Chu's suggestion of having a separate arrangement to scrutinize the controversial items. I think that this contravenes the intention of block allocation. So let me clarify whether there should be a pull-up mechanism for the block allocations is not the sole view of mine. I remember that last November, for example, like Len Qicheng actually supported this view. So I think that on that last meeting, so the day afterwards, the Oriental Daily News have quoted a lot of pro-establishment members, and actually Mr. Chu's views is echoed by a lot of the pro-establishment camp members. So the Bureau's response is inappropriate, that if you think that it's contravening the intention of the block allocation, but so what is the intention anyway? So the block intention anyway, actually the block allocation is arrangement authorized by the FC. The crux of the matter is whether it contravene the intention of block allocation, whether it break up the Article 73 of basic law or any existing legislation or a public order, finding ordinance or this subsidiary legislation. If there's no breach of legislation, I don't see why there's energy to achieve a cross-party consensus of conferring a new mandate where for controversial items that would not have something minor or similar. Sometimes we see that as a bound by collective voting. Let's say for Wang Chao, because I need to support the block allocation, then I have to hold back my chute to support the Wang Chao development project. So how can I face the villagers? That's why we have to the proposal of a pull-out mechanism. I hope that the Bruce can explain that how this proposal to take out country items that would breach the ordinance or existing legislation.
The Secretary. Now, last time I spoke, now in Annex 1 to this letter of 28th of February, spells out the government's stance. Now, when Mr. Choi Dick mentioned the basic law, now on page 2 of my speech, we talked about the review of the principle of the mechanism, and I quoted Article 62, bracket 4 of the basic law. Now, that was about the powers of the SAL government, and it also referred to Section 1 of the Public Finance Ordinance, and it said that the mechanism should not be amended. And also in the FC and Public Works Subcommittee procedures, it said that the proposal for expenditure should be proposed by the Financial Secretary and then voted in LegCo. And what we said was according to basic law, according to public finance ordinance, according to the rules of procedure of FC and PWSC, this should be the correct approach. Otherwise, the several thousand items of the block locations can be subjected to various pulling out, causing many problems. So when we provided this letter, as I mentioned, regarding paragraph 9 and as explained by the Deputy Secretary, now we are following the constitutional arrangement. We should go ahead with the block allocations. Now, even though this is with the empowerment of the LegCo, as we explained, we have made a commitment that is in paragraph 9, 1 and 9.2. We committed that we will not commence the land resumption ahead of receiving the funds. This will address members' concern that the government would take advantage and do something before endorsement by the FC. So this was our commitment. Now, if when needed, we need to engage in some advance works and resume some land. Now, we even though we don't have a pulling out mechanism, in such cases, we will first approach the relevant panels for discussion. And as the Deputy Secretary explained, if during discussion members were seriously concerned, then we will take note and we would review the procedures. Any other questions from members? Because we do have to enter into discussion. Houghton Chow, Fernando Cheung, and three more, and then we have to discuss the paper. Houghton Chow. Thank you, Chairman. Now, I have heard what has been said. Now, I have a suggestion. Now, Joy Dick's thinking is that if there is controversy, there should be a mechanism for pulling out the item. Now, my thinking is this. Now, on what is controversial or not, now, in actual operation, sometimes there can be quite a lot of arguments, even about what is controversial. So, there's a possible solution. Now, if we encounter cases where early resumption of land has to be instituted or some advanced procedures have to be undertaken, if there are rather exceptional items like these. Now, in such exceptional cases, I suggest that first, there should be in-depth discussion at the panel level. Now, after discussion in the panel, if members feel that this is difficult to deal with, this is complex and merits further discussion, then this should be agreed at the panel, and the government should be requested not to put the item into the works list of works projects, and then it would come later as a separate item. So this should be dealt with at an early stage, and it should not be included in the capital works reserve fund block allocations. So I don't agree that there would be block allocations regarding the CWLF, and then certain items would be pulled out, because that would be controversial. The panels should discuss that in advance. If the items are controversial, they wouldn't those items shouldn't be included in the list for block allocation. Dr. Fernando Cheung, I don't know whether the administration will respond positively to Mr. Holden Chow's suggestion. That is, if there is controversy at the panel level, then the government will not put in the item. Now, however, not every item is discussed in the panel. Now, by the time the matter is discussed, has taken its turn and is discussed in the panel, the works might have already started. Now, there are over 10,000 items of different natures. Some involve land resumption, some resolve compensation, some affect people's habitats. Now, those are often controversial, whereas slope maintenance, drainage, welfare services, those are not controversial. Now, you can put them in, no problem. What we are talking about is that there should be a mechanism for to pull out the relatively controversial items so that the capital works, which are basic works, can go ahead. Now, Mr. Lau said you should have reference to the basic law. It must be passed in one lot. Now, these items are proposed by the administration, even for today's budget. You can put that to us as a whole, and then we can pull out certain items. For the budget speech, members will propose amendments, and those pulling out would be equivalent to that would be equivalent to pulling out some items. So if we can take out the controversial items, that would be overcome. Now, there are only several controversial items: Wang Chao, the Agri Park, Kun Tong Reclamation, Southern in Wan Chai, and so on. Now, we argued about these several items. Now, if we take them out, then it will save a lot of time. Now, the chairman wants efficiency. That's an efficient way. Mr. Lau, we were comparing just now among ourselves. Now, our procedures for block allocations, we did go to the panels to listen to members' views. I asked Mr. Raisin Lau to speak. Now, as the Secretary said, before we come to this meeting, we go to the three panels. We tell the members of the list of items, and there are numerous items we cannot brief them on members on every one of them. But if members are especially concerned on any one item, we would be glad to explain to them both during and after the meetings. If members have strong views on certain items, the government would take on board their views to decide whether the items should remain on the list for block allocation to be presented to PWSC. Now, members are concerned about land resumption items because these might involve irreversible acts, and members are concerned that they may create fait accompli. And the government has agreed that if we need to resume land in advance, we would pull them out, discuss them in the panels, and listen to members' views. If members feel strongly about them, as the Secretary explained, the government would carefully consider whether to maintain our original plan to include that in the block allocations. If we decide to persist, there would be a clear and a strong reason, and we would explain that to members in the panels and the FC, and if members are not convinced, they can vote us down. Shuhai Dick. First, on the pulling out mechanism, now I couldn't convince the Secretary, and nor has he convinced me yet. Now, the Legal Services Division has not joined in this discussion, and whether this is in breach of the basic law, I think we can set that aside for now. On the resumption of land, the administration is willing to propose the new mechanism. I think I feel positively about that. Yes, it's true that we are concerned about irreversible land resumptions. When you have this new mechanism, then it already deals with the controversy surrounding the pulling out mechanism. So I'd like to make one point. Now, if in accordance with the administration's proposal, when there are strong views in the panel, when there is objection, and then the land resumption item is taken to Finance Committee for vetting, now would that be against the basic law and relevant legislation? Now, if that doesn't contravene the law, then we should discuss that a little further, a little bit here. Why? Because if we depend on the administration understanding of LegCo's thinking, and LegCo, and if LegCo doesn't have the power to negate the proposal, I think that's not desirable. I think we should not leave the administration with all the discretion. So perhaps the Secretary can clarify for me if the panel issues endorses a motion against your advance works. Can you put that in the FC for voting? Now, if the panels have strong views about our advance works, now I believe the department normally would take on board members' views and not include that in the block allocation applications. If there is a special reason for that, there are ways and means. One way is to take that out from the block allocations and then get funding along with the main project. And also it can be included among the block allocations, and the department will have to explain why this is advantageous for the public. Whichever way, If it's proposed by the government, of course it wouldn't be against any law. Deputy Secretary, now this would be quite quite rare. Now, it wouldn't be as Mr. Holden Chow said, because, we approve the block vote for land resumption in New Territories Northeast, and then by the end of next year, you say you would embark on it, and then you come back to the panel. Now, actually, we already granted you the funding in the block allocation, so it's not inclusion after discussion. Now, we should be talking about new land resumption items. Now, if we have new land resumption items, and if we put them among the block allocation requests, now, and if we if there's the chance that we need to use the funds in advance, we would certainly go to the panels to seek their views. Now, if the process already started, then that would be different. Now, if you can write further to the administration for discussion.
So there is a deadline because we have to approve this before April the 1st, otherwise there will be serious repercussions. We are not going to have too many meetings in March, so let's, you know, have exercise good time management. Let's come back to the questions. Mr. Lau Kwok Fun. Chairman, I would like to defer to the other members first. Originally, I was going to say something else. Why don't you, you know, go ahead anyway? I agree with the proposal, the new approach by the Bureau. I think there are two main issues here. First of all, the question is whether or not this will become a fait accompli. What the controversies mentioned by the other members, I think we've discussed it many times before already. For any particular issue, different people will have different views. Whether or not this will become a fait accompli, I think the new approach of the Bureau can certainly resolve that. It would also give us the flexibility so that in Northeast NT, whether you can reserve more funds in advance for resumption, so that you don't have to. I think the two can go in, can proceed in parallel, and I think this is a good approach. It will give us the flexibility for the funding reserve for resumption. It's reserved. And when we go to the panel, there is still time and room to discuss whether or not we should use the funds which have been reserved. So this new approach basically means that we have reserved funds for the land resumption. So I think we've resolved the questions whether or not we are creating a fait accompli, and I think this will provide greater flexibility for land resumption in future. And I hope that we can implement this approach for NT Northeast first. Are you going to continue to comment on this item? Well, we don't have too many other members left. In that case, I'm going to proceed to the vote very soon. Holden Chow, Chairman. I'd like to follow up on a point I made at an earlier meeting, that is for item 708, head 708. And there are two items involving the public housing development in Chung Ah Road, Tai Po. There is also a child care center and also a home and residential care and home for the elderly. Other than the daycare, child care center, and the center for the elderly, there are other welfare facilities as well, including some training centers. At the last meeting, I remember that the administration has already answered my question. That is, those welfare facilities will not be paid for by the block allocation fund, but rather through the lottery fund. Now, could you tell us at this moment, could you tell us when will the funding be allocated from the lottery fund? Yes. Who would like to take the question? I'll invite a colleague from the SWD to answer the question. Yes, SWD. Now, who would like to take the question? Thank you. Thank you for the question. I'd like to clarify for the Chung Ah Road project. Other than the home for the elderly, for the other funded projects, they are funded by the lottery fund. Okay. So it will be funded by the lottery fund. So I'd just like to ask this. I asked the same question last time. So we know that it's funded by the lottery fund. The question is, at this point, can you estimate how long funding will be approved from the lottery fund? Could you give us a timetable? I don't know whether you're able to give me an answer. If you can't, then perhaps you can give us a paper after the meeting if you don't have the answer right now. Do you have the information offhand? Chairman, I'd like to further clarify that other than the home for the elderly, which is going to be paid for by the lottery fund, everything else will be paid for by the block allocation. The projects for the Chung Ah Road in Tai Po, funding has already been approved. So the lottery fund, in other words, has already approved the funding. Mr. Lau Chan, could you supplement? I think Mr. Chow is asking for a timetable as to when we're going to implement those projects. We will be happy to provide the details after the meeting. Yes, please do that after the meeting. Bernardo Zhang. Thank you. I'm getting a bit confused. Mr. Wong, Assistant Director, said that other than the home for the elderly, everything else will be paid for out of the block allocation fund. But earlier, you said that other than the home for the elderly, everything else would also be paid for by the lottery fund. So I don't know which is which. I heard two different versions just now. That is on pages 61 and 62 for the 16 projects. I thought that they were going to be paid for by the Capital Works Reserve Fund. Is that so? Or is it that some of these projects will be paid for by the lottery fund? Could you give us a clearer answer? Thank you. Let me further clarify that for the funding for the home for the elderly, it will be paid for by the lottery fund. For the other welfare projects, they will be paid for by the Capital Works Reserve Fund. For the development project in Tai Po, Chung Ah Road, both the funding has been approved out of the lottery fund and the Capital Works Reserve Fund, and works have already started. So other than the home for the elderly, you're saying. But on pages 61 and 62 of the paper, I don't find any details regarding the home for the elderly. Are you referring to... So other than the one in Tuen Mun, but you refer to Chung Ah Road and Tai Po. You're talking about the home for the elderly in Chung Ah Road and Tai Po. It's not included here. It comes under the funding by the lottery fund. That's correct. So this is rather confusing. Well, Chairman, I asked the same question last time. That is for the Capital Works. I think I asked the same question at the PWSC. I'd like to ask the question again because I have not given a clear answer. For the welfare facilities, my question is, based on what principle do you decide which projects that will be funded by the lottery fund and which will be paid for by the Capital Works Reserve Fund, or anyway, you know, government public funding. So what criteria do you adopt to make the distinction? Thank you. According to our funding arrangement, the the project costs for these welfare facilities will be paid for by the lottery fund. But welfare facilities in public housing projects, other than the home for the elderly and welfare facilities in government complexes, the cost for the relevant projects will be paid for out of the block allocation for capital work projects. Chairman, you said the general, you know, welfare facilities. Let's say for on page 61, you know, facilities for those who are seriously physically handicapped, dormitory for the seriously mentally handicapped. These are not, aren't these ordinary welfare facilities? You say these are normally paid for by the lottery fund. I thought you just clarified that. For these 69 items, they will still be paid for out of the Capital Works Reserve Fund. Why is it that the principle you told us does not tally with the facts? Thank you for the question. Perhaps there's a footnote to what I said just now. Normally, for most, normally all these expenditure on welfare facilities are paid for by the lottery fund, subject to a cap of $30 million. So if it is cost up to $30 million, it's paid for by the lottery fund. If it's, it exceeds $30 million, it will be paid for by the Capital Works Reserve Fund. Let me explain the whole situation again. According to the established funding arrangement, for the normal welfare facilities, they are funded by the lottery fund. For large public housing projects and the welfare facilities inside, other than home for the elderly and welfare facilities in government complexes, such project costs will be paid for out of the Capital Works Block Allocation Fund, subject to a cap of $30 million. Chairman, I think they may need to give us some papers to further clarify. I just want to find out the principles according to which they would determine the source of the funding. We hope that the lottery fund can provide more services. I didn't know that the lottery fund also pay for these capital work expenses. In developing new services, if the lottery fund is willing to commit more resources, I'm happy to see that. I would like to invite the SWD or the Bureau to give us a detailed paper afterwards to explain the distinction. Okay. Energy? Thank you. I have a question regarding 6100TX 67NRC0OI. I'm not too sure. The Mui War Hengxi Road, you know, and the redevelopment of that that road. Can you find that? I think I would defer to the Highways Department. Can you find that? The redevelopment of the Mui Wo Hengxi Mui Road. Thank you. What exactly is Mr. G asking? Yeah, I'm about to ask the question. I found, first of all, that the Chinese and English version don't tally. In the Chinese version, you said redeveloping the Hengxi Wo Road. English version, redeveloping EVA. So, in other words, you're telling us there is an EVA there. The question is that according to the Transport Department, there is a restricted zone order for Mui Wo between Ngansek Street and Mui Wo at the intersection of Ngansek Street and Mui Wo Hengxi Road, and 30 meters to the west, there is an unnamed road which is a closed area around the clock. I think if you are familiar with Mui Wo, that is from between the pier and the Hengxi Mui Road, there is a river. once you cross the bridge there, you would reach the closed area. Earlier, there used to be an iron, you know, a gate to block the traffic into the closed area. I don't know since when the gate was removed, and now in this project, the EV you refer to, I mean, previously only emergency vehicles could travel on that road, but now that the fence, the gate has been removed, other vehicles can also enter the area. So I'd like to ask the department whether you are aware of the situation. And I also like to know whether the EVA, according to the government's understanding, is now going to be open to all vehicles. And the closed area order is no longer being enforced. Thank you. Regarding the question raised by Mr. Chu, I have not prepare the material, the information to answer the question. Perhaps I can provide the details after the meeting. So I only have 2 minutes left, but I'll still go ahead anyway. A shorter question. This is for the director of the AFCD. So when we discuss the role for phase one, the director said that there was a need to build a two-lane both-way road. According to the situation at the scene, from Fen Kam Road linking up with the new road, that section of Chilking Road is actually single-lane dual-way, both directions. And the department told me that they have no plan to widen the road there. So you now have this very odd situation. But your road is two lane both ways, but the road going to there is only one single lane both ways. So do you have a timetable? If you're going to make it two lane both ways, you should start from Fen Kam Road all the way to that section. Do you have plans to do that? And if not, why? Why you insist on dual lane both ways for Yip Kin? Thank you. Regarding the widening of the Chilking Road, we will explore that further in phase two of our study. For phase one, you will proceed with phase one first. But you said you are considering to do that, but does it mean that you will definitely proceed? That we need to conduct a detailed study for phase two. We need to review the operation, overall operation, before we can make a decision. Energy. Now, do I need to go to the Chilking village and tell the villagers there that for phase one, you've now agreed, and Chilking Road definitely will be widened? It's not possible that there's two-way, both directions inside and outside. It's only single lane both ways. Mr. Leo, perhaps I can defer to the director of the CDD to answer the question. Mr. Lam, for the agri farm, we are now looking at the design. And Mr. Ji is correct that at the moment, the road is only single lane, both ways. In the design in future, we will explore how we are going to widen Chilking Road so that it will become a standard road. We're working on that, and once we have more details, we will consult the public. When will you have the information? Well, you can, you know, wait for your next turn. Chen Chichin, after Mr. Chen has finished, we can probably finish. I'm sorry. Only 3 minutes. I noticed that I have 2 questions regarding the XRL terminus in Kowloon. In head 709, subhead 709, there is one item for 2017-2018, a project started, and in 2017-2018, 2018-2019, you have projected expenditure for the XRL Hong Kong section and the water supply system for West Kowloon XRL. 2018-2019, 1 million, and then 1.59 million for 2018-2019. Well, the XRL will be completed in the third quarter of 2018. Will this project have to go on until 2020? Otherwise, why there is still this cash flow? What is the progress? WST, Mr. Wong, I believe Mr. Chen Chi-Chin is referring to this. The small items in the annex, right? I have this form. In form one, you have a breakdown of your cash flow for every year. For 2018-2019, the estimate is, I think more or less I know what you are referring to. For that item, we're talking about the laying of certain pipes outside of West Kowloon. And there's still some outstanding projects we need to finish because we need to lay some water pipes to supply water to the West Kowloon terminus. I can certainly collect more information and provide an answer to Mr. Chen. There is another item regarding the XRL terminus, and that is the CNG's department's IT facility. This is Project 171. Again, for 2018-2019, is 1.39 million. 2019-2020, the cash flow is 110,000. So the same question: shouldn't these projects have been completed before the commissioning of the XRL in the third quarter of this year? Why is that you still have to wait until 2020 before it's completed? Yes. Secretary?
I believe the words you're referring to, the information, the computer system project, this we have bills payment period. So this works would finish at the same time and be commissioned for the 2019 to 2020. This is just the out. So this payment, since it's time. So I will compensate Mr. Chen for the time, and now the meeting is adjourned. Thank you all.